Are we live? Welcome to programming that's insightful, authoritative, and at your fingertips.
Bringing news alive. So immersive, so new, and so addictive. You will want it no other way.
The Bloomberg Terminal, accessed only by over 325,000 marquee investors across the world until now.
Business people. You're watching Bloomberg Quint Live, and I'm Menaka Doshi.
I'm Neeraj Shah, and you're watching Indian Open. Morning, Menaka. Morning, Ira.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning to our viewers. These are our headlines. Asian markets open on a cautious note ahead of data-heavy week. No sign of caution, though, in the Bitcoin market, where prices surge above $9,500. Will bond markets respond to a disappointment from Standard & Poor's? The rating agency kept India's sovereign rating unchanged. Outlook remains unchanged as well. The Labour Party is set to win the Queensland's vote, dealing a blow to Adani's coal mine project.
And those stocks are likely to react today, unfortunately, not in the same vein as Bitcoin, which is just on a spore of its own. I read a tweet.
800% this year.
Yes, and that if you
invested... You sold your house, your clothes, your shoes, your car, and your laptop.
No, just probably shoes. That's it. I invested in Bitcoin 7 years ago.
I'm not sure your shoes would buy much, but...
Yeah, but still. Well, yeah, so let's look at the trade setup for the day. And the markets are unlikely to start off in the same way as Bitcoin is doing. So, in fact, we'll start off on a negative note. I don't think, look at this from an S&P ratings perspective. Yes, I know there's been a bit of a pause and maybe traders will be disappointed. Hey, what happened? But I think both the S&P status quo as well as the Asian market setup will delay any kind of new highs that we may have had today or over the course of the next couple of days. We'll start off about 0.5% lower for our markets. Index options, remember, have seen a big build up around the 10,300 to 10,500 mark, and the Nifty PCR as well indicating that that's the band at which we'll probably find support and resistance. Remember, it's expiry week, so volatility may pick up as well. And it's a data-heavy week for our markets and for the global markets as well. But speaking of India, Q2 GDP data, the OPEC meet and its impact that it has on the 30th, we'll have the outcome thereof. So all of these could keep our markets positive. I don't know what's happening with the pronunciations today. And the monthly auto sales data on Friday will be watched very, very closely as well. So do watch out for that. In terms of stocks to watch for today's session, L&T, it's a Bloomberg report that Schneider has entered into exclusive negotiations to buy the electrical and automation unit. So do watch out for that stock. I think two very interesting mutual fund purchases that happen in Friday's session, and those stocks could be excited. I've picked up two out of many, but GHCL because DSP BlackRock MF has bought about 1% stake, and Vardhman Textiles because Franklin Templeton has bought about a 1% stake. Interesting purchases there. Let's watch out for these stocks. Rain Industries could be in focus. Remember, after falling all the way from 378 all the way to 305 or thereabouts, the stock has started off again on an upward trajectory. And one of the subsidiaries looking to issue new credit facilities to refinance the bonds. This could this could bring down the cost of finance for rain industries consolidated over the course of the next couple of years. So this should be interesting for rain industries as well. And the Adani Group might have a sentimental impact. I use the term sentimental because it's not a done deal as yet that the Labour Party might come in back in power. But if that happens, and with a presumption that they'll stick to what they've been saying in the past, this could deal a bit of a blow to that rail project. And therefore, Adani Group stocks will likely start off on a negative note. That the market is not doing well will also play a part here. But the Adani Group will definitely start off on a negative note today.
I think Thursday is going to be the tough one. Thursday, if I understand correctly, is going to be India GDP data, IIP data, OPEC meeting. Of course, the Global Entrepreneurship Summit will be underway at that point in time in Hyderabad. So we'll have Ivanka Trump here. So it's going to be a busy day for journalists on Thursday.
So GDP versus Ivanka Trump. What are we going to focus on?
Ivanka Trump, my dear.
If I heard the podcast as well, I think the second revision of the US GDP
yeah, that's the second revision. Yeah, so that's also on. That's, I think, the day before that. And then through the course of this week, we have Federal Reserve people speaking. So it promises to be a busy week. But let's tell you what's on First Work this morning. We take a look at why S&P and Moody's have divergent views on the Indian economy. We also look at how poor drafting and confusing linkages in the ordinance that was promulgated last week pertaining to the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code may unwittingly hurt independent bidders. If you were amongst the few brave ones that were investing in Indian equities at the time the world was going to nothing, that is the Lehman crisis, well, you could be a very rich person today. We have a special report on how much money you could have made. And we'll also tell you that it's advantage mid-caps in the IT industry. Differentiated players stand to gain in the era of digital, cloud and artificial intelligence, or AI. But we'll kick it off first with why S&P was not quite in the mood, I'm so sorry for the bad
really?
To change its view on India.
Okay.
Sorry. Apologies all round. Okay, sorry. I'll take it back.
Now, we've had the news for 2 days, and 2 days is a long time in the news cycle, so we're not going to spend too much time. But, you know, just because this came after markets closed, it came late in the evening on Friday, and then there was a whole bunch of chat on is Moody's right, is S&P right, and all of that. Essentially, you know, neither of them is wrong, because if you look at the rating, not the rating per se, but the rationale backing the rating, their understanding of how India is right now is very, very similar. So, you know, their rating, S&P kept their rating at BBB-. Moody's has upgraded it by one notch, as we know, to Baa2. The outlook remains stable. I think the real disappointment perhaps was just that S&P didn't move their outlook to positive, because I know some people in the market were expecting a rating change. That was slightly, you know, that expectation was not realistic, because they would have moved to a positive stance before they moved to a rating change. But they haven't even moved to a positive stance, which means that a rating change is some time away. If you look at what they're saying on various indicators, so for instance, if you look at growth, S&P on growth says that they expect India to grow robustly in 2018-2020, that period. They talk about the fact in the near term, confidence has been hit by both demonetization and GST teething troubles. Now, Moody's took a similar view. They adjusted their growth forecast downwards for the current year and said that you'll rebound in FY19. But they also tried to spin, and I'm not using the word spin negatively, but look forward and say that this will all add to India's growth potential. S&P did not do that. On government finances, S&P was a little bit worried because they said that they expect the center to quote-unquote broadly succeed in controlling deficits, but they also pointed to state-level deficits and said that that will continue to add 3% to the consolidated deficit. And they pointed out that these high fiscal deficits over a period of time have led to accumulation of debt. That accumulation of debt is 68% of GDP, which Moody's also acknowledges, but for some reason, Moody's said that the reforms that have been taken should add to the sustainability of debt, and they pointed to the FRBM Act. We are broadly stuck to the FRBM trajectory, so Moody's took note of that, S&P not so much. Essentially, if you look at both rating agencies, what is the differential between them? It's essentially S&P saying that, look, we know, and they say in their statement that a lot of reforms have been pushed through, but they don't make a judgment on the impact of those reforms. They say the reforms have been taken, but they're perhaps waiting to see some proof of how those reforms play out out before they take a call on it. Moody's has taken the long view, has taken a leap of faith, as we said earlier as well, and expect all of those reforms to deliver. So that is essentially the difference between the two rating agencies. This morning, there's some talk of bond markets reacting. Perhaps they will. Yields had already climbed up over the last 2 days of last week. So you're back at 7% or so. Maybe you could see a few basis points higher. I'm just going to take this opportunity to bring out the real problem for the bond markets and what you really should be watching. The chart that I'm watching very closely is the banking liquidity indicator chart, because you're very, very close to neutral liquidity. And that is the real change in the bond markets. That is the real change that you need to watch for. That is the Bloomberg Intelligence banking liquidity indicator. It tells you we are very close to that zero line, which is neutrality, which has happened more than a year later. It's been more than a year since we've gotten to that point.
So what will Fitch do?
Somewhere middle of the line. Fitch typically is the last to move, you know, in terms of giving their reviews. I would be surprised if they move on the rating. They can't move on the rating. They are at stable as well. At most, they can move to a positive outlook.
So what happens to, you know, I know we discussed that what is the big gain of a change or an upgrade in sovereign rating is the access to funds or cheaper funds, so to speak, right? Right off the bat of the Moody's thing, we saw the Reliance refinance that went up.
Yeah.
So how do markets now decide whether to offer Indian corporates cheaper funds or not if two rating agencies have held two divergent views on this?
So I believe, and we chatted about this on Friday, so I asked a few people, they said in terms of the number of people who follow various rating agencies, S&P has the highest followers, but most investors tend to take note of all three. So something like Reliance, you know, they benefited from the change in sentiment. There was that one day where there was this huge optimism, you know, credit spreads sort of contracted a little bit and they were, you know, quick off the bat and managed to get that deal done. But I think, in terms of who follows who, various agencies would have, you know, a hierarchy, but S&P apparently has the highest number of followers in terms of people who link their
investments. So that will at least, you know, I think it come to the aid of those Indian corporates that are looking to raise funds, right?
Yeah,
at
possibly.
This point in time. All right, that's the divergence between rating agencies. Now a quick update on that Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code Ordinance. It's intended to rule out defaulting promoters, but it may hurt independent bidders as well. And here's why. I'll explain to you. Well, it mostly has to do with poor drafting, as lawyers are pointing out, and some fairly confusing linkages. I won't get into the technicalities this Monday morning, but it has to do with the way connected persons has been defined in the ordinance, and then how connected persons includes related parties, which is defined in the IBC. And when you try and read all the language together, it suggests that, you know, even a bidder like ArcelorMittal could hurt, and I use the word could very, very carefully here, because there are several legal interpretations out there. Could hurt simply because it is a more than 20% holder in Uttam Galva, which is a distressed asset, right? So being more than a 20% holder makes you a related party. If you're a related party, you fall under the definition of connected. If you're connected, then you cannot participate or submit a resolution plan, is how the IBC puts it. The other one that could potentially be hurt is JSW Steel. This is due to the promoter's connection with JSPL. So Sajan Jindal promoted JSW Steel. Sajan Jindal is the brother of Naveen Jindal. Naveen Jindal's company is Jindal Steel and Power. Just a short while ago, we know that JSPL was labeled as an NPA. Now it's not clear whether it continues to be an NPA or not. Some lawyers and bankers I spoke to said, hey, it's paid back the money because it did some asset sales. It's no longer an NPA. What is clear is that it has not been an NPA for a year, right? That we know for sure. So that's what would save it. But I'm just using this as an illustration to show you that had it been an NPA for a year or more, because of Naveen Jindal's connection to Sajan Jindal and Sajan Jindal's ownership of JSW Steel, JSW Steel might also have been precluded from submitting a resolution plan. And we know both these companies, and I've only used these two examples because we know that they are interested in the bidding process of many assets out there right now. Now, like I said, I've spoken to half a dozen lawyers over over the weekend. Each one of them has given me a different reading of the law. So it's terribly confusing at this point in time. I took this argument to Seshagri Rao, the Joint Managing Director and Group CFO of JSW Steel. He completely disagreed with me. He said that's not true at all. We've read it several ways ourselves and there is absolutely no impact on our group, except for this one thing that he said. He said, now I have to sit with every resolution professional and explain with detailed documentation that I don't attract these ineligibility criteria. And why this is a cumbersome task? Because at JSW Steel, there are more than 35 promoter entities. So Mr. Rao is going to have to sit with every resolution professional and for more than 35 entities explain how none of their related parties or connected persons actually draw the ineligibility criteria in this IBC and therefore it's all kosher. So the paperwork, you know, increases multifold in this process. That's the feedback we're getting from JSW Steel. Therefore, I think that's one thing we wanted to flag off. Lawyers are telling me foreign bidders may also be hurt unwittingly in this because there is one ineligibility criteria which says that any of the Indian criteria that may apply to you in a foreign jurisdiction. So one lawyer said that, Menka, if there was any foreign bidder that had any connection to any NPA in any other jurisdiction, it may or may not impact that foreign bidder's ability to submit a resolution plan. At the very least, they will have to go back and create all the documentation for that just to make sure that they fit into the terms or the criteria as laid out by the IBC. Now, director disqualification is a big worry. If you are a disqualified director in one company, but another company that you are a director in wants to make a bid for an asset that's in the resolution process, can that bid be considered ineligible, especially in the light of the fact that about 3 lakh directors have been disqualified recently as the government cracks down on shell companies. So the reason I'm going through all of this morning is just to show you what some not perfect writing can do, to the process at this point in time. I'm sure that if they do put their mind to it, the government can rectify all of this when this goes to Parliament, because every ordinance has to be confirmed by Parliament, and we'll see that happen in the winter session itself. That's what most lawyers and company executives are hoping, that this will all get clarified. But till it doesn't, they're all worried about the fact that it might just amount to a lot more paperwork. And especially when you're dealing with, 12 resolutions, from the first round of RBI, another 30, then for each promoter entity, you have to show the paperwork. So it could amount to just a lot of pain in the backside. So that's the story on the IBC, and that's what lawyers have spent their weekend doing.
Wow. Well, not a pretty weekend then, I would guess. Okay, thanks for that, Menka. On to an interesting piece of analysis. It's been more than 9 years since the Lehman Brothers filed for bankruptcy. But taking the wind out of equities across the world then, it was, in fact, the largest global sell-off since the 1990s. A lot has changed since then, of course, with equities showing resilience and emerging markets like India attracting more foreign investments than ever before. So how much would a brave few who decided to take the plunge back then by buying the Nifty stand to make right now? I think Darshan has done an interesting bit of calculations because, Darshan, unless I'm very wrong, this calculation doesn't show what would you have done if you bought the Nifty by itself, but the Nifty components in a different kind of a way, if I'm not wrong.
So what we've done is basically two things. If you invested 50,000 rupees on the Nifty that day on 1st Jan 2009, because that was post the Lehman crisis, and for a better calculation, we decided to take 1st Jan 2009 against, if you divided 50,000 rupees equally, not as per the weightages, 50,000 rupees, 1,000 rupees each in the 50 stocks of the erstwhile Nifty. So you'll put your money in your Unitex and your Suzlons also, because they were Nifty constituents. So basically, on the broad Nifty itself, the market cap of Nifty on 1st Jan was almost 19 lakh crores. It's moved to almost 75 lakh crores from 2009 to 2017. The Nifty has given returns of almost a 3.5 times or 242% if you had invested. So that's the broad sense that we're getting as far as the Nifty is concerned. Majority of the stocks have done extremely well for the Nifty. Look at Maruti. It's on a profit of 1,453%. HCL Tech, Tata Motors, TCS, M&M. Majority of the stocks, while some of them have actually given you very bad returns like an Arcom, Unitech, Suzlon, Reliance Power, Reliance Infra. So a lot of ADAG groups feature, a lot of real estate groups feature among the companies that have given you poor returns as far as. So this is the broad heat map that we're looking at. Basically, the other factors that you have to watch out will be basically 24 stocks outperformed the benchmark indices. So Nifty gave a return of 242%, but there were 24 stocks which gave returns in excess of 242%, some as high as Maruti, which were up almost 15 times. And only 10 stocks gave negative returns. So this is what we are looking at. So individually, if you're looking at it, how much you would have invested? There were some big changes, no doubt. Cessa and Sterlite merged, and then Kane was bought into Cessa, and Vedanta was created. So there were some broad changes into the Nifty, also some M&As that happened. Ranbaxy went into Sun Pharma. Both of them were Nifty companies at this point of time. Reliance Petroleum went into Reliance Industries at this point, at that point of time. Satyam Computers went bankrupt. And finally, it was taken over by Tech Mahindra. So these were some broad changes that the Nifty had that time. Now, basically, let's take a look at some of the changes that had happened and what the returns would have potentially been. 50,000 invested in the Nifty 50 and 1,000 in each of the Nifty 50 stocks. So we'll tell you what exactly happens. So if you invested 50,000 in the Nifty, your money would have actually become 242%. So if you can get that slide, we will tell you. So Nifty 50,000 invested would have become 1,21,000. And if you had invested 1,000 in all the 50 stocks, that would have become 1,50,000. So your strategy of investing in the Nifty 50 stocks would have given you a return of 24% in excess of what would have happened if you had invested in the Nifty itself. So this is the broad sense that we are getting, Neeraj. And individually, we'll speak about some of the stocks also.
Yeah, if we can do that as well. This is interesting also because, Darshan, taking a leaf out of this or otherwise, DSP BlackRock has launched an equal Nifty 50 fund as well, wherein okay. They are trying to follow the same strategy. But if you can give us some details about individual names as well.
Yeah, so let's get Maruti. I think the slide was already out. That's been the biggest outperformer that we've had. So Maruti, if you had invested at 1,000 and the market cap was 15,000, you would have returns of 1,453 crores. So your 1,000 rupees would have become 15,530. So this is the biggest outperformer as far as the stocks are concerned. The second stock that we'll talk about has outperformed is HCL. Your 1,000 rupees would have become almost 14,000 rupees and a market cap of 8,000 has become 1,20,000 crore market cap, returns of almost 1,300%. The next one will be Tata Motors. It's struggling now, but from a level of 1,000 rupees, your money would have become almost 13,000 rupees with a return of 1,167%. You had your TCS, one of the second largest company in India. 1,000 would have become 11,000, return of almost 10 times. And finally, you had HCL Tech, with M&M, which your 1,000 rupees have become 10,150. So this is the broad. So individually, if you had invested in these companies, you would have almost 5 of the 10 baggers here in a matter of 9 years. No doubt with ups comes the down also. There have been certain companies which have underperformed. So if you had invested 1,000 rupees in Reliance Communication, you would be left only with 60 rupees now. The market erosion was 94% there. Look at the companies, the other companies, Unitech. 1,000 rupees, if you had invested 1,000 and kept on holding it, you would have just 140 rupees in your hand. Marked underperformer given the fact that the 2G issues, Suzlon, another Nifty counter which actually made a lot of claims. So 1,000 rupees became just 210 rupees. The other stocks is Reliance Power, so another one by ADAG. 1,000 would have become 310 rupees. Market cap lost by 70% here. And finally, BHEL, the biggest capital good company, your money would have become half. If you had invested 1,000 rupees, that would have become 500. So you can see that there are outperformers and there are clear underperformers also. But so clearly, this strategy proves that, if you had invested individually in stocks, you would have made much more money. It's time to play the sector rather than the trend because trends like real estate and capital goods were losing trends. So it's time to get out of those stocks and invest in other companies. But since we're here, let's have some fun. We'll tell you some stocks and what would you have made. So if you had invested and you were the big guy and you'd invested 10 lakhs in Maruti in 1st Jan, you would have been able to afford an Audi RS7, which cost 1.6 crore rupees. So that's the broad sense. So that shows the power of compounding. If you had invested 10 lakhs in HCL Tech, let's look what you could afford. You can afford a BMW 7 Series, which cost 1.4 crore rupees. So you three should look at these because these are the cars probably if you're looking at it. Tata Motors, obviously you can afford a Land Rover itself, cost 1.3 crores. If you had invested 10 lakhs in a TCS, you would be able to acquire a Jaguar that is worth 1.1 crore. And finally, if you had invested 1 lakh in M&M, you would be able to afford a Porsche, which costs 1 crore. So clearly, trend is your friend. You should play the stocks that outperform and the sectors that outperform. A lot of winners, but some losers also.
So much irony in the sentence. Had you invested 10 lakhs in Maruti, you could have been able to afford, what was it?
It was an Audi RS.
You would have been able to buy.
So you would have been able to upgrade from an Audi A4, I believe, to an Audi RS7.
I'm not sure why you think we're all walking around with bags of cash or something like that, right? Pretty much anybody can afford these cars on financing, no?
Sure. Yeah, but it just gives a trend, and this just shows you the power of compounding. Sure. If you had invested in good quality stocks and you know, exited the bad quality stocks, because you know, at that time infrastructure was the in thing, but the time you realize, and you know, if you looked at it, auto and IT were the ones that gave maximum returns. So if you had bought instead of one each of the best of all the sectors, you had bought the best of the best sectors, you would have made far more money.
Yeah, well, I suppose also all of this is predicated on the fact that if you had held your nerve and were buying, as opposed to, you know, sort of tucking your tail between your legs and running into some corner, holding all of your assets in cash. So, thanks, Darshan. That was really insightful and interesting, and also a bit of a car shopping trip. let's move on now to from Lehman times to technology space today. Neeraj?
Yeah, just a small thing. I mean, you know, how difficult it is for investors currently. And the reason I bring this up is because traditionally large investors would be wanting to invest into large cap IT. That's the more liquid pocket. Here, just the last two quarters, the trend that is emerging, and I'm not talking about the differentiated technology companies. It'll be difficult to say that, oh, large investors can invest in these companies as well, because it's difficult for a mutual fund manager to bet on an 8K Miles or a Vakrangi or an AppTech in a really big way. The returns given by these three stocks over the last 6 months are exceptional, and not looking at them. Keep in mind, I'm just looking at the plain vanilla comparable large cap IT versus mid cap IT. Now, there is a chart that if my producer can bring that out, I don't know, but there's a Bloomberg chart which shows the last 6 month returns of what mid-cap IT has done versus what large-cap IT has done. And the chart on the three names on the first half of the chart are the mid-cap IT names, and you'll see the trend. All of them are veering upwards in almost the similar fashion. The returns, of course, vary. Versus the three large-cap IT names, and I've omitted Infosys from this because that's a special situation stock, but TCS, Wipro, and HCL Tech, the remaining three, and look at the returns there. At best, they've maintained the kind of money that investors would have made, but they've also lost certain stocks have also lost money, noticeably Wipro, which is the red line as well. And now, look, this is what I'm trying to say. One thing, in large cap IT, the last quarter, the numbers that came out, while, you know, the only silver lining were the resilient margins, because the constant currency US dollar growth was sub 2% by and large for all the large cap IT names. The problem comes here. Valuations versus the expected growth rate. Infosys, after the recent run up the last 2 days, trades at about 15 times, 14 and a half times. I've used 14 times. The guidance is for 5.5% to 6.5% growth. TCS trades at 17 times. Guidance is 6% to 8%. Wipro, 16 times, aided, of course, by this buyback. And that keeps the stock price inflated because of the higher price. But the guidance was extremely muted. You could argue that the numbers would be anywhere between 4% to 6% or thereabouts. HCL Tech, which is trading at about 12 times, the guidance is 10.5 to 12.5. But I think the management mentioned in the interview to us that they'll probably grow at the lower end of the guidance. Tech Mahindra, 11 times. The guidance is at 10 times. Now, you would argue that people would probably bet on, if they want to bet on large cap IT, bet on HCL Tech and Tech Mahindra, because the valuations are cheaper and the growth rates are higher. But the valuations have consistently for the last few years remained cheap for HCL Tech and Tech Mahindra vis-a-vis the other three. So even if with a superior growth rate, they don't find the buyers. Compare that to what is showing growth. And I've just picked up three names. These are just illustrative, not really the whole universe, but Sonata Software. IT services growth for the quarter at 7.5%. Stock currently trading at 12 times FY19 EPS, which is not expensive for a company that will grow probably northwards of 12, 13, 14 times. KPIT Tech, management expected FY18 revenue growth at 12%. The stock is trading at 13 times. Emphasis, it's been more agile. The relationship with Blackstone portfolio companies helping it. trading at 13 times. Again, growth rates northwards of 10 times. Hexaware raised the dollar revenue growth expectation for calendar year 17 to 14 to 15%, trading at about 13 times. So that's the conundrum. You have large cap IT, which is not showing growth, and trading at about 14 times, so you can't go out and buy that. You want to put money into IT because everybody's saying that, hey, IT is looking like getting back from the brink. Mid-cap IT is showing growth, but valuations from sub 10 times have moved up 12, 13 times. So the performing space on which you can't place a large bet is becoming slightly more expensive. And the space which has stayed lower in terms of valuations, which is the large cap IT pocket, is not showing growth. 6 times, 8 times, 9 times at best. And you don't want to bet too much on HCL Tech and Tech Mahindra. As history shows, people don't bet too much there. So if you want to bet on IT as a fund manager because you believe that, hey, the growth might be coming back, or at least valuations are in your favor, where do you put in the money? It's a classic conundrum.
Yeah, well, interesting. Well, there must be ways to create an IT portfolio that is a mix of both, let's say, a couple of large caps and a couple of mid caps to be able to gain the best of the growth as well as the ability of the large cap or the more established companies, to move ahead on I think some of these new streams of AI, digital, etc.
Yeah, so fund managers did that 2 quarters ago, but you buy maybe about a percent and a half of mid-cap IT companies like Sonata or KPIT when they were sub 10 times. Now that they are 13 times, 14 times, you wonder whether you can bet about and buy about a percent and a half, 2% of what is arguably a lot less liquid company than what an Infosys TCS would be. So it's a classic conundrum of sorts right now.
Very interesting. All right, I think that's all we have for you on First Word this morning. But before we head towards the day's trade, here's a quick programming note. We discussed markets and macros with Harsha Upadhyaya of Kotak Mahindra Asset Management Company. That's coming up in just a short while. Later on in the show, we'll also discuss growth drivers for Nesco with the executive chairman of the company, Sumant Patel. Make sure you stay tuned for all these special conversations.
But for now, full tilt towards the day's trade. Agamukhli standing by with all that could happen in the derivative space today. It's an expiry week. Good morning. And expect some volatility to pick up.
Absolutely, Neeraj. We are expecting volatility, especially given the fact that we saw the VIX come off. But before I go to the VIX, let me just address what's happened as far as the futures go. So we have seen unwinding, of as much as nearly 6% in the Nifty futures. This is the beginning of the unwinding of the November futures in general, considering we go into expiry. But on the other hand, when it comes to the Nifty bank futures, we have seen an addition of nearly 2%, 2 to 3% in terms of open interest. To a certain extent, this is towards the longs, considering we saw the index close in the green. But when it comes to the VIX, as I was mentioning earlier, it has come off down as much as 2.6%, currently at around 13.5%. Moving in, as far as the PCR is concerned, that's moved up higher at around 1.46 as against 1.35. And in terms of the changes in open interest that we saw last Friday, we saw more writing in the 10,400 put and unwinding in the 10,300 and 10,400 calls. We'll be watching out for those levels as the Nifty tries to inch towards the 10,400 mark. In terms of changes in the F&O band, well, we have a lot. So we do have the likes of GMR, Infra and Syndicate Bank move into the band. On the other hand, the likes of DLF and TV18 will see increased trade as they move out of the band. And of course, Jubilant Foodworks will also be in focus, considering we have seen near 41% increase in open interest towards fresh longs. We'll have to wait and watch whether or not that momentum holds for Jubilant Foodworks. But of course, again, all eyes will remain on the benchmark indices as we move into today's job trade.
Okay. Thanks so much for that. We will talk to Abhijit about some of these strategies as well. But good morning, Abhijit, Phatak. Thanks so much for joining in. While we had some bit of buying on Friday, Abhijit, suffice to say that will get erased in the session early morning today. What should an average Nifty trader do?
The breakout which tried to happen at 10,400 did not sustain. And that was more largely because of the OI of the 10,400 call. But I still believe Nifty is bullish, and any dips should be taken, long should be taken on dips. And what I'm looking at is the 10,400 call on a lower side, 25 to 30 premium should act as a support on any dip. And 70 will act as a resistance on any rise. So Nifty will oscillate between these two, 25 on the 10,400 call and 70 on the 10,400 call.
You are bullish on the Bank Nifty call option in Friday's session, Abhijit. What's the call there? Still hold on to that 26,000 call?
Yeah, that you can say one can still hold on to that call with the stop loss of 50. It went to 95 that day, and it came down again. And one can buy it again if it is available near 70 with a stop loss of 50. I believe it can go beyond 100, and I expect Bank Nifty to go towards 26,000 before expiry once.
Before I ask you about your strategy, Abhijit, just one quick word on a couple of consumption names. I don't know if you noticed some interesting F&O activity there. Jubilant Foodworks and Titan.
Jubilant is a very bullish stock. In fact, for the last few months, it has been bullish, and it has every dip has been bought into it. And I believe it is still bullish. Over the next few months, I expect Jubilant to cross 2,000 also. So any dip is a buy in Jubilant.
Okay. Lastly, this Infratel call that you've given today, is this for the current expiry?
Yeah, it is current expiry because on the daily chart, Infratel is resting on the 200 DMA, and that should act as a support near 375. So any dip toward 376, 377 should be bought, and with a stop loss of 373, 374. And I expect it to go cross 380. And on a positional basis also, it can be carried forward for a target of 390 or even 400.
Okay. Abhijit, thanks so much for taking the time out and joining us today on Indian Open and giving us your thoughts. Well, equities might be hot. Commodities, I think, were reasonably active in Friday's session. Let's talk about them with Pradeep. He joins in to talk about the commodity markets and to take the show forward. Morning, Pradeep. I heard Darshan in the morning on All You Need to Know saying that, by and large, base metals had a fairly active day in Friday's session.
Yeah, definitely. And some of the base metal, for example, you know, copper has moved up for 7 days in a row now. So that's looking strong. Other base metals are also fine. In fact, even gold is holding strong. That is because dollar has weakened a bit. And if you look at the movement of dollar index was holding below 93 level. Now, that is around 2 months low on Friday that was seen on that currency because of the you know the euro gaining a lot of strength and due to that, if you look at the overall movement in gold, it continues to hover closer to $1,300 mark, though it's not able to really breach it. Markets are also looking at the congressional hearing of Fed chair nominee Jerome Powell that is on Tuesday, and there is an interesting report quoting a Russian central banker which says that Russian Central Bank is increasing the gold reserves in their forex kitty, actually. To talk about crude, crude is also sustaining at higher levels. If you look at WTI, it hit a high of $59 and quoting very close to that level. Now there is an all-important meeting of OPEC and other oil producers on Friday, which oil markets will be looking at. But, you know, mind you, 38% gains we have already seen since June, you know, ever since the compliance went up and the production cuts were actually put into effect. So there is a very strong uptrend in crude that we have seen, and Friday's meeting is going to be very crucial after that. To talk about some other commodities, sugar closed at a four-month high. In early Asian trade, if you look at it, steel is trading higher, aluminium is higher, copper, as I mentioned, is higher for 7 day. Zinc is one base metal which is quoting lower. All the other commodities are actually looking strong.
Okay. Let's wait and watch what happens to some of those back stocks. Let's also take a quick check on the Asian markets for the benefit of our viewers who are tuning in right now. We'll have a start which is marginally in the red. Let's wait and watch what happens during the course of the day. But let's talk about trade and stocks and markets with Pankaj Pandey, head of research at ICICI Direct, joins us right now on the show. Pankaj, good morning. Thanks so much for joining in. Let's start off with the news that Bloomberg has reported about Schneider being in talks with Larsen & Toubro for one of their units, valuation of about $2 billion odd. What does this mean for, I mean, one, Schneider Global, that's a separate thing altogether, but Larsen & Toubro, which continues with its strategy of moving away from the non-core assets and hiving them off?
Yeah, hi, good morning, Neeraj. You're right that, reported division was the L&T was looking to sell this division for quite some time, and if this news pans out, I think that will be very positive because L&T structurally has been looking to sort of move out of non-core areas and improve their ROEs in the subsequent few years. I think if that happens, it will be very big positive. In addition to that, I think Hyderabad Metro is another asset which and plus they are also looking at some of the road assets going forward in terms of for divestment. So I think once that happens, the balance sheet of this company will be very light. If you look at on the working capital side, the company has been doing a very efficient job. Though I think last quarter, we did not have that kind of order inflows. But given the fact that the stock hasn't really performed well, we expect the overall infra theme to sort of pan out very well in the subsequent or next few quarters. And L&T is an attractive play in that. And I think at current levels, the risk reward is quite favorable for the stock.
Okay, so you really like L&T here. Well, if you look at it, Pankaj, of late, IT stocks have been kind of supporting the index in a big way. Are you increasing weightage on the sector?
No, actually not. So I think if you look at both IT and pharma, the growth is still a challenge. Especially, for example, if you look at tier 1 IT names, the growth is still challenging. But what is also happening is that if you look at some of the key performance verticals, say for example digital, which is contributing say 20 to 25 odd percent for some of the tier 1s, I think if this vertical is growing 20% on a YOY basis and the overall weightage will keep on increasing, I think then the IT would sort of get preferred. But I think there's still some time away for it. From a valuation perspective, I think if the liquidity remains at elevated levels, I think the IT would be the next sector wherein people would look to sort of buy, because in terms of FCF yield or in terms of PE multiples, I think the entire sector looks attractive. I think their growth volatility is far more lesser compared to pharma, because pharma is very difficult to sort of pencil in terms of what kind of pricing decline which could sort of pan out in the next 1 or 2 years, given the fact that pharma nearly contributes 30 to 45 odd percent for some of the big companies. So that pharma is a far more bigger challenge compared to that. IT is far more easier to sort of take a call on. So I think IT with better prospects could be looked at. But at this point in time, I think the growth is still not sufficient enough to sort of take a call or to increase the weightage. But yes, within the two space, I think IT looks brighter at this point in time.
Okay, I mentioned that because Infosys moved up by around 5% over the last three sessions. If you also look at the Aptechs and NIITs of the world. But let's see which stocks are going to move today. What is it our research team is really eyeing? And to talk about that, our team is actually ready to begin with. I think I'll go to Yatin with Motherson Sumi.
Absolutely. And, you know, if you look at Motherson Sumi, they hosted an analyst meet in which they were talking about the outlook for 2020. In fact, the management has reiterated its stance as far as the Vision 2020 is concerned, and they've maintained their ROCE as well as the revenue target, which is quite, you know, on the aggressive side. They say, you know, that the expanding presence across business verticals will probably drive the growth moving forward. In fact, CLSA has maintained outperformed with a target price of 400. Of course, CLSA is only concerned about weakening auto demand in Europe, and probably because of which they have not revised any target price for Motherson Sumi. As far as Deutsche Bank is concerned, they maintain a hold with a target of 330. They say that the management in the analyst meet said that, there is no significant impact on Motherson Sumi as far as the electric vehicle segment is concerned, as well as the driverless car segment is concerned. In fact, the company supplies to 6 of the 10 top EV models sold globally. So, you know, that is on the positive side. Nomura maintains a buy with a target price of 442. And in fact, they say that BS6, the management said that BS6 in India, that could be a very large opportunity for a company like Motherson Sumi, wherein the wiring harness content could increase by almost 30 to 50%. Credit Suisse maintains a hold on the other hand with a target price of 350. They say that the company is looking to diversify into non-auto segment as they you know, plan to meet the 2020 target. So probably like a Bharat Forge, they are also, you know, planning to move off autos and get into newer businesses. However, the company says that China will be a focus area for SMR, you know, which is a subsidiary, because the market share as far as the mirror segment is concerned in China is quite less, and probably the focus area for the management will remain a large market like China.
So, Yatin, I've heard you several times in the last few days. So, basically, analysts like those auto ancillary companies which don't supply the products which are only for, you know, the liquid fuel autos, yeah, and which will not be used in EV.
Yeah, and
so Motherson is saying.
Yeah, and you know, if you look at electric vehicle, the component you know, requirement is quite less. Motherson is on the wire harness side. Mirror, you will still require mirrors, right? Even if you are an electric vehicle. So on Motherson Sumi side, probably they don't feel in the short term there could be some impact. But of course, companies who supply crankshafts, gears, or probably engine equipments, you know, and combustion engines, in the auto ancillary space could suffer if we see a very disruptive move from the electric vehicle side, or probably there is a sudden surge in demand, sudden shift. Which comes in from the consumer side.
Okay, so that's auto ancillary. But Darshan has been reading lots of strategy reports of late.
Yeah, I think earnings season over, so people now come out with broad global strategies. So two of them have come out, Macquarie and Morgan Stanley. So Macquarie, their report indicates the fact that they expect recovery to still be narrow. However, they say that their growth will normalize in 2018. Expect GDP growth to improve to 7.2% in calendar year 2018. The recapitalization of PFC banks improves the outlook for capex according to them. And the growth factors pretty much will be consumption, rural recovery and exports. They do believe that RBI will be on a pause in 2018. Now, there's one more note that's come out, and that is Morgan Stanley, which probably agrees with what Goldman Sachs said in terms of rate hike. So what they've said, first of all, they are confident about the prospects of recovery in private capital spending. Corporate return expectation and balance sheet fundamentals are being rather strong for corporate India, and the strengthening financial system should make investment credit demand. They're saying that they see a full-scale recovery that could come in 2018, and RBI will likely hike in the second half of fiscal 2019. So that is something that they believe. So that is some of the strategy and reports that have come out as of today.
Mm-hmm. And Nikki is tracking some of the small cap numbers, I guess.
Yeah, so a lot of numbers, the fag end of the season almost done. But then the positive set of numbers that we're looking at to begin with first is Bharat Bijli. Extremely strong in terms of operating profit. If you look, revenues first have risen at 20%. Net profit has come down by 4%, but look at the EBITDA figure. That's almost 567% jump at a 10 crore figure as compared to 1.5 crore in the base quarter. Margins for that matter, they have expanded to 5.8% as compared to nearly 1% that we saw in the corresponding quarter. Now, good sales and higher optimization techniques by the company has aided the EBITDA growth, but then higher tax outgo and lower other income has led to the dip in the profitability of the company. If you look at the Excel industry numbers, revenues, net profit, EBITDA all have a decent good set of numbers there. Net profit has risen 67%. EBITDA is up by just 56%. Now, muted top line, but cost optimization measures and higher sales has led to a good EBITDA growth for the company. Also, for third good set of numbers that we're looking at is King Science. Their net profit has risen almost by 25% at a number of 5-odd crore. EBITDA, for that matter, has also jumped up by 43%. Apart from good performance at operating level, there's also a sharp jump in other income that we're looking in for this company. Fourth set of good number that we have is Shaily Engineering. Their net sales have risen as much as 21% and the profits are up as much as 34%. This is mainly on account of decline in the overall operating expenses and finance cost combined with your higher other income, which has translated well in your profitability. In weak set of numbers, you have revenue. Indosolar Q2 FY18 numbers, not so good set of numbers. If you look, EBITDA, the company has reported an EBITDA loss of 9.5 crore as compared to a profit of nearly 11.4 crore. Quickly, the last set of number, Oriental Carbon and Chemicals, there the net sales have jumped up by 77.3% and the profit has come down by as much as 17-odd%. This is on account of higher tax outgo, depreciation and your lower other income despite cost efficiency coming in from the company.
So Excel, Kingfa, Indosolar, some of the names to watch out for. What else are you watching, Shraddha?
Adani Group of Stocks, of course. More so Adani Enterprises, as the Labour Party is closed in on majority in Queensland. The counting, I believe, is still going on. We don't know, but if that does happen, it's negative for Adani Group of companies. You also have JP Associates, which has fixed 28th November as the effective date for restructuring of its FCCBs that were maturing 2017. So what they've done is they're going to exchange the FCCBs maturing in 2017 for those maturing in 2021. You have Rain Industries, where its subsidiary Rain Carbon is looking to issue new credit facility to refinance 2021 bonds again, which will bring down interest costs. So positive development there. Saturn Credit Care is looking to raise funds from the promoters, from IndusInd Bank and two other investors, Nordic Microfinance Initiative Fund and Cora Investments, and that will be at a price of 335. The closing price on Friday was 388, so watch out for that name. GPT infra projects. The subsidiary has won an arbitration against NHAI and they've got awarded 62 crores or so. So some marginal positive reaction could be seen there as well. On the back of bulk deals, of course, we saw RBL Bank react on Friday. We didn't know who the selling investor was. So it's Norwest Venture Partners. They have sold 1.4% stake. They still have about 0.2% stake or so remaining in RBL Bank. And DSP BlackRock Mutual Fund has probably made an entry in GHCL by buying 1% stake. So again, some reaction expected there.
Well, thanks everyone for all these details. And moving back to our guest, Pankaj, auto ancillary, we spoke about Motherson Sumi. Now, what do you really like in this sector? Because it has been buzzing. It has been an outperforming sector, really.
Right. I think the biggest challenge for auto ancillary companies has been the disruption which could potentially get caused by EV. I think within that, if you look at CV as a space is offering little threat from a EV perspective because either the vehicle can carry weight or it can carry a load. So from that perspective, it is still not an immediate or a near future threat. Having said that, there's some stocks, some segments which we like. So tire is one example which we like at this point in time because of the fact that globally, if you look at the prices, have softened for rubber. In addition to that, we like some of the mid-cap or small-cap names like MM Forging, which was a part of our Diwali pick. I think this company, if you look at Derive, has got a diversified segment. So Derive a decent chunk from CV plus other auto segments. And their threat or potential threat from EV is a little less compared to the other players. And in addition to that, they have installed a new press, which should lead to better machine components and higher margins. So from that perspective, these are some of the names which we like. But overall, the challenge for a number of auto ancillary players remain. I think the OEMs are far more safer at this point in time from that perspective in terms of EV disruption.
Let's wait and watch Motherson, though. The interesting bit is they are reiterating their revenue guidance and most people, 2020 revenue guidance, and most people believe that there's an outside chance that they could slip as well, because I think in this investor meet that they had, they mentioned this revenue guidance of $80 billion by FY20. So that's something to watch out for. But they're very interested in watching what happens to some of the high flyers of Friday's session, just before we get in Summit, particularly future retail. For everything that people may talk about, how expensive these stocks may be, 9% 2 days after the retail 3.0 strategy is announced suggests that there is some serious institutional buying that would have happened here, because a 30,000 crore market cap moving up 9% 2 or 3 days post the news only suggests that this is digesting the news and then taking a call on a stock which is apparently looking expensive.
So actually, if you look at it, I think the last bit of restructuring in the group happened some 6 to 7 quarters back. And since then, when this company in its current form really came into existence, it has been an outperformer, I think, at least for last 1 year. This one has been doing quite well. We discussed about it, I think, last week also, that, you know, you made more money investing into future retail.
And Avenue Supermart,
In secondary market.
In secondary market.
So this has been a clear outperformer. And I think retail sector has completely become a discovery of 2017. I don't know how 2018 will go. We'll probably talk about it as we get closer to that. Another pocket that I would like to highlight is the gems and jewelry and the gold finance companies, if you look at the last week's movement. So Titan, on day one, after the result, it hit a high and then corrected. But on Friday, it has closed at a level which was higher than the highs of the post-result day, which means a new breakout. We got a report on PC Jewelers from Motilal Oswal last week, and that stock is also looking very strong. And even if you look at the Muthoot and Manappuram, while we didn't probably focus much on these two stocks last week, but they are also doing very well and all set for a fresh run. So let's see how they really do. There are so many talks of, you know, maybe some stimulus for this sector as well.
Just one last point. I know we're just running slightly over on time with Sumit's Bloomberg Edge, but just one last point. Since you bring that up, I don't remember who gave that report, but there was this report which said that delinquencies, or maybe it was a Times of India news article, that delinquencies in gold loans have been lower than what's been in home loans and one more set of loans in the quarter gone by. Gold loan companies, the loan growth has been okay. and the delinquency rates haven't been that high, which is, well, again, since you brought up Manapura and Muthuta, I just thought I'll bring that point. They're no longer only those companies, but still, it's an interesting set of data points, quite frankly. But anyways, me and Pradeep can go on and on with a lot of things. It's time to get in Sumit Sarkar, a couple of minutes over. Sumit, excuse me, and excuse viewers for actually just going ahead of the time. But he joins us with that pattern that the Bloomberg terminal is throwing up today on a very special segment, Bloomberg Edge. Sumit, what's the stock on your radar today?
It's IndusInd Bank. Now, today on Bloomberg Edge, it is the trend indicator which has turned bullish on IndusInd Bank. It has generated a buy signal on the stock. So what is Trender? It's a proprietary Bloomberg indicator which is used to manage current position. Now, it uses average true range for its calculation, which helps us to manage stop loss. So how do we interpret Trender? It's very simple. It's a buy signal when the trender flips from red to green, and it's a sell signal when it flips from green to red. Now, if you see on the chart, the Trender indicator has now moved on above the red line and has turned green and turned bullish on IndusInd Bank.
Okay, so now that we have that zoom in on the chart, I think what Sumit is trying to indicate is the last candle, Sumit, wherein that move has gone above the red line.
Yes.
Exactly. And what would this indicate, Sumit, if you can just repeat for the benefit of our viewers?
It means it has generated a buy signal. So you should now, according to the trend indicator, you should now buy IndusInd Bank, and there's a certain upside still there in the stock. That is what the trend is indicating.
Okay.
And also backtesting this data has shown that in the last 1 year, if someone would have bought or sold shares according to this indicator, then it would have given him returns in more than 58%.
Oh, 58%. So that's really interesting, IndusInd Bank. Thanks, Sumit, for the details and for the benefit of our viewers. Let me reiterate that Trender is a proprietary Bloomberg indicator, and we highlight some of these stocks which have given a breakout or a breakdown on some of these proprietary indicators every morning. Moving on to our technical expert, Ruchit Jain, technical analyst at Angel Broking, who is joining in. Ruchit, it's almost given that since there was no upgrade from S&P since Friday morning, we have been expecting a lower opening for today. If you look at the movement in STX Nifty, I think 25, 30 points gap down is likely. What do you do next?
Good morning, Pradeep. Pradeep, if we see the entire last week's activity, then there was nothing much to be done on the index front. We have traded in a very narrow range in both the Nifty as well as the Bank Nifty front. And even if we talk about the 20-25 points gap down opening, I don't think that's a huge reaction to the news. What would be important, how the market reacts after opening, after the first half an hour at least, would be very crucial, because we have seen a phase of a consolidation and now we are into the expiry week. So usually during the expiry week, the volatility tends to be higher. So what is happening that if we see the open interest front in the Nifty as well as the technical charts, the 10,300 mark on the lower side has become now a very strong support. Even a 10,300 put as the highest open interest, as well as technically there is a strong support base over there. And on the high side, 10,410, which is 78.6 retracement of the recent corrective move, as well as last week high, becomes very important, becomes a very crucial point. So the next directional move in the index would depend upon whether 10,300 is broken first or 10,410 is taken out first. So I think as of now, traders needs to wait and watch as far as trading on the index front is concerned. If even after a 25 points gap down opening, if the index manages to cross 10,410, then we can expect a directional up move during this week. So I think rather than the opening front, the first half an hour would be very much crucial as far as index is concerned.
To the pre-open, so where do you really see the trade? Give your picks.
Yeah, if we go on the stock specific front, then we have a couple of buy recommendations since we have seen during the last week that it was more of a stock specific market. We have a buy in Manappuram Finance. You just spoke about this gold loans companies, Manappuram Muthoot as well. We have seen during the last week this stock has attracted very good volumes comparatively what we usually see on the daily charts, and also prices have given a breakout and has given a good closing on the weekly charts as well. So we are recommending to buy Manappuram Finance for this week, keeping a stop loss below 102 and expecting target around 112. And our second pick is a buy call in Brigade. This mid-cap realty space specifically has been attracting very good volumes since last couple of weeks. Brigade is one of the stocks which has seen a consolidation phase of about 4 months, and after 4 months of consolidation during last week, prices have given a breakout. So we are expecting that post this breakout, the uptrend would be resumed in near term. So one can buy with stop loss below 288. The risk reward is very much favorable. We are expecting targets around 330.
You know, watch out for two interesting names, GHCL, wherein DSP BlackRock has bought about 9.5 lakh shares at about 272 rupees. So watch out for GHCL. And watch out for Vardhman Textiles, wherein Franklin Templeton Mutual Fund has bought about 7 lakh shares, which is 1.2% of the equity. And that one at about 1,300 rupees. So those are the two names that viewers should watch out for in the session today. Pankaj, GHCL, any coverage there?
No, Neeraj, we don't have a coverage on that stock.
Fair call. Okay. And Vardhman Textiles, by any chance, it's not a very liquid stock, so I'm throwing this out of the dark at you.
So on Vardhman, we expect the margins sort of improve in the subsequent quarters, because at this point in time, the margins were impacted because of the high cost cotton inventory, and which is what we expect should benefit in terms of higher prices. So we like that stock within the textile space.
Would you be a buyer here? I mean, there is a large mutual fund which is bought, but would you be a buyer in Vardhman at all? Pankaj, I don't know if you have a buy or sell or a hold call here, just asking this.
No, we have a buy on the stock. We'll be buyer in the space.
Okay, Franklin Templeton Mutual Fund has bought 7.15 lakh shares of Vardhman Textiles. Do watch out. And Pankaj Pandey also reiterating that they have a buy rating on this stock. So do watch out for Vardhman Textiles in the session today. What else, Pradeep?
So really, if you look at it, last week, the CLSA report that came out also talked about textile as one of the focus areas going forward. So there is definitely, you know, rising interest in this entire segment, if you look at it. Also interesting would be the NBFC space, although we are very close to pre-open. But Pankaj, quickly, in 30 seconds, do you like any of the NBFCs?
I think within the NBFCs, we have limited coverage, and Bajaj Finance and FinServ, these are the two stocks which we like, Bajaj Finance especially, because I think the growth rate is maintained, and we like this space on the consumption side, which they are addressing. And I think this stock has seen a decent amount of correction also, about 10-15% of with correction and with better growth. I think this is a stock which one should look at.
Satin Credit is raising funds, and Muthoot just recommended by Ruchit. So these two stocks in NBFC space to watch out for.
Okay, and the pre-open rates, well, it's a sea of red across the Asian bourses. The SGX Nifty indicating about a third of a percent in the red. Don't look at these green rates. We will not have a start in the green, even though the Nifty may be indicating this for now. I think watch out for what happens to the Adani Group stocks. There should be a sentimental downtick. In these names should bring up. This is probably a more believable rate on the Nifty now, the Nifty pre-open rates. Let's bring up Adani Enterprises and actually the entire Adani group of stocks. There should be a sentimental reaction thereof, 3-4% off. Remember, it's not a done deal as yet. One, the election result. Two, what could happen as an outcome as well, because things could well change. But for now, the Adani Group stocks under a bit of a cloud in today's early morning trade. Larsen & Toubro could be an interesting one as well. Large cap name. An asset sale may not really move the needle too much, especially when the market is down about a third of a percent or a half a percent. But do watch out for this one as well in the session today. And, well, there are a clutch of names that we will watch out for, especially in the mid-cap IT space as well. Mindtree has been upgraded by Credit Suisse with a price target of 600 odd rupees, and it should be interesting to see if Mindtree is reacting thereof. Yes, 4.5% higher, 534 and counting. So that one would be an interesting stock as well in the session today, and some result reactions, of course, that we will talk about.
Definitely. So these are some of these stocks really to look at. You know, the mid-cap IT space is really looking interesting. But we'll also focus on the two indices, this being the expiry week, really. Ruchit, we talked about the Nifty, and we'll also talk about Bank Nifty going forward. But before that, Soumit Sarkar is standing by with some more details on some interesting brokerage calls. So let's go across to Soumit first.
So on brokerages, first we have is Access Capital on Security Intelligence Services India. Now they have initiated coverage on the stock with a buy rating and a target price of 1180. Now the India business of SIS has been growing at three times its GDP growth, while the Australia business is a cash cow with steady mature market and high cash flow coming in from that business. Given the faster growth in India, they're expecting their revenue and profit to become more India-centric going forward. By financial year 2020, Access Capital is expecting India business to contribute around 55% and 65% to the consolidated revenue and EBITDA of the company from current 45% and 52%. Overall, they're expecting the company's consolidated revenue, EBITDA and net profit to grow at a compounded annual growth rate of 17%, 24% and 33% over FY18 to FY20. They're also expecting the return on capital employed of the company to average around 30% over FY18 to 20, mainly because of its high Australia business, high contribution coming in from the currently coming in from the Australia business. However, recession-proof business, sticky customer base with annuity-to-revenue stream and under-penetrated Indian market with organized players gaining more share are the positives for the stock. Second, we have is Deutsche Bank on General Insurance Corporation of India. Now, they have initiated a hold rating on the stock with a target price of 830. Now, they have a hold rating as the risk-reward is balanced for GIC. Dominant 60% market share, improving financials and combined ratio of 100% are the positives for the stock, while the B2B business model, tightening competition and investment income driving profits are the negatives for the company. Now, the key crop business has been volatile but is still not a concern according to the brokerage. However, higher competition because IRD has now allowed foreign insurers to open branches in India is a key concern for the key concern when it comes to GIC. However, they are also expecting the combined ratio to modestly improve over FY18 to 20. They are expecting the combined ratio to be around 99% and return on equity to be around 17 to 18% over FY18 to FY20. They are expecting the net return premium and net profit to grow at a compounded annual growth rate of 14% and 13% over FY18 to FY20.
Okay. Thanks a lot for that. Sumit, Rahul Shah, Vice President for Equity Advisory Group at Motilal Oswal, joins us right now on the show. Rahul, good morning. Thanks much for joining in. Before we get to our set of questions about stocks that we want to ask you, what's been the top conversation in the morning meeting today? What are the sectors, what are the themes that you at Motilal Oswal are telling your clients to buy today?
I think we have always been bullish on the NBFC space and then select NBFCs. I think, again, we saw some kind of correction in this. So I think we are looking at those NBFC space again. So Bharat Financial is one which we've been talking about. We saw some kind of momentum building up on Friday in the stock. So that stock what we've been like talking about for, that one can look at for trading. Secondly, L&T Housing Finance is other stock which has seen some recent fall. So I think it's near the support level. So I think that's again the stop idea what we've been talking about. So I think fairly, I think financial is a sector what we've been liking at from current levels.
Okay, so watch out for Bharat Financial, L&T Finance and a couple of other NBFCs. Beyond NBFCs, Rahul, in terms of the stocks which are in news today, anything that has been the center point of chat in today's meeting?
I think we'll see maybe Sun Pharma should be on focus. We saw some momentum on Friday and again today maybe should be on the focus. So that again looks interesting at lower levels if we can get it. That's one stock we've been talking about. And I think that's for the main. And then second was, I think we recently updated on Interglobe Aviation. Looking at last week, we came out with a full-fledged report on it and the overall market share of the aviation as a sector. So in that space, I think again Interglobe remains our top idea. So these are the two another top ideas what we've been talking in the morning meets.
Okay, so Amit, we just discussed a report on SIS coming from Access Capital last week. Also, we had a report I think from Kotak. So SIS and also Quest Corp, two stocks which are probably not strictly comparable, Pankaj, but more or less in the manpower management business, so to say. Do you like any of these?
So we don't have a coverage on both, but I think as a business model, Quest Corp looks quite attractive to us.
Okay, so you don't really have a coverage on these. Ruchit, have you been tracking the chart? Because all three stocks, including Team Lease, were very active last week.
So if you see in terms of the volumes, then Quest Corp is one of the stocks which has attracted very good volumes during last week. Teamlease, usually, although the trend is up, the stock has been forming high top, high bottom structure, but the volumes are usually not that higher. But Quest Corp, definitely, it seems that the stock could head much higher from current levels in near terms itself. The way volumes panned out on Friday with an up move, it seems that on the higher side, if we take out the reciprocal retracement of the recent corrective move, then it is giving a target projection somewhere around 1020, 1030 mark, which is much higher from current levels. I think from a trading perspective, if anyone has to go long in among these three stocks, then Quest Corp should be the one where one could create a long position for target somewhere around 1020 to 1030.
It's a pretty muted start seemingly. The 8 minutes are about to come to an end. I was about to mention Jacob because Jacob in the pre-open rates, at least the first 3 or 4 minutes, was showing an 8% uptick. Now it's cooled down as well. Similarly, the big movers in Friday's trade, the likes of Praj Industries too, have come off a little bit in the session today. So do watch out for these. Rahul, gems and jewelry, it's a pocket that is interesting. There could be some sops that could come about as well. Is there a trading or an investment bet into any of these large counters or mid-sized counters?
I think definitely this sector has been in focus, and post Titan's results, we have seen a lot of upgrades coming up in the entire sector as well. So in that, obviously two large players, I think, in a listed space, I think, and one is Titan. So Titan looks very interesting from here on. Also, the most of the including us, a lot of brokerage houses have upgraded their earnings post the commentary of management. So I think Titan one should still look at, though the stock is at all-time high, I feel still reasonable upside one can look at it. Secondly, in that same space, PC Jewelers, I think that again is set to give you the good kind of return. The stock again has done quite well from the end this year. So I think obviously post GST and the demonetization, we've seen this sector to be more organized and more favorable in near term and in a longer term as well. So I think these two are the top ideas what we've been recommending in that space.
Mm-hmm. Well, if you look at some of the interesting stocks, Videocon is up 4.5% following the reports that they have arrived at a settlement outside the NCLT process actually. Aditya Birla Fashion is another stock from textile that we were talking about, which is moving up, is up close to 2% in today's trade. Future Lifestyle and Fashion from the Futures Group is also doing well. Pankaj, we were talking about retail sector before you joined, I guess. What is that you like in this segment? Where do you really have a buy recommendation?
So within the retail space, if you look at, so one of them is Shankara Buildcon, which we like. I think what we like is that it's a satellite model, and a company over the period of time, next 3-4 years, would look to double their store count. And this stock is an interesting play on the entire consumption or house building space. In addition to that, I think Trent and Aditya Birla Fashion are quite attractive according to us on the fashion side. And I think on the jewelry side, if you look at Titan, is one of the few companies, or overall, if you look at it, is one of the few companies which is expected to deliver good double-digit returns. Last particular quarter, if you look at, they delivered about 30% odd kind of a return. Now, jewelry is a segment wherein, if you look at the organized play, is substantially smaller compared to the unorganized play. And I think the way they displayed growth in the last quarter in excess of 30 odd percent, I think very few companies can do that on a sustained basis. I think Titan has the potential to sort of deliver that kind of a growth rate. And I think they've also addressed one of their key gaps in terms of not being present in the wedding jewelry, so which they have sort of plugged. And I think from that perspective, all these companies which I've mentioned, Aditya Birla Fashion, for example, had a bad quarter last quarter because of GST. But I think subsequent quarters, we would expect the companies to sort of pick up in terms of performance. So these are the kind of names which we expect to sort of post double-digit growth. And these are the stocks which we like on the entire retailing space.
Okay. 9:11, 4 minutes to market open. That time to get you all that you need to know to stay ahead in trade today. Let's start off with the first set of stocks. Adani stocks will be in focus as the Labour Party closes in on a majority win in Queensland. Adani's Carmichael coal project may face a risk.
Rain Industries subsidiary Rain Carbon looks to issue new credit facility to refinance 2021 bonds.
Bloomberg reports in that Schneider may offer a $2 billion bid for L&T's electrical and automation unit. That should keep L&T in focus.
Well, Bharat Bijli, Kingfa Science, Excel Industries, Oriental Carbon and Shelly Engineers reported strong numbers for last quarter.
Shriram City Union Finance, Manappuram Finance, Cholamandalam Finance and PNB to meet a set of investors today.
Credit Suisse upgrades Mindtree with a price target of 600 rupees. Deutsche Bank initiates coverage on GIC Re with a price target of 830 and Axis initiates coverage on SIS with a price target of 1180 rupees.
That's very interesting. SIS has been finding a lot of takers really the last few days. Pankaj, before we let you go, one quick thought. Do you guys have SIS within your coverage?
Actually, you know, we don't have a coverage on this entire space, but like I said, Quest Corp is what something we would sort of have active in our minds. I think so from that perspective, this one stock is what we would look at. But I think overall, this space is quite interesting because somewhere down the line, the staffing need for the overall industries or overall economy is going to increase. And I think this is one segment wherein I think the lower segment is sort of still unorganized. I think that is where these companies actually plug the loophole. So from that perspective, it's a very interesting space to be into and different from the normal IT models what you see.
Yeah, for sure. Well, even some of the smaller names that are now starting to come up in the SME space are deriving a lot of traction there. Pankaj, thanks so much for taking the time out and being with us this morning. Appreciate you joining us. Okay, less than a minute left for trade to start. Let's get in a sense of the top trading call from both our experts. Ruchit, I'll come to you first. Bet on one stock for the day. Which one would that be?
I think the jewelry segment that we have spoken about that even in today's trading session could do well. Titan is indicating a good gap up opening again after last week's enough move. So I think either Titan, PC Jewelers, these would be the names where I think even on intraday basis, we should see good returns.
Okay, so Titan and the jewelry names, but Titan in particular is Ruchit's top call. Rahul, if you had to bet on one call for the day today or for the next couple of days, which one would that be?
I think I mentioned earlier also, I think Bharat Financial is one stock which we've been liking it. So I think I would bet on that with a target of 1,050 in the next couple of sessions.
Okay, Bharat Financial Services from Rahul's end remains the top draw for the day, for the next couple of sessions, quite frankly. Stay on, gentlemen. We'll probably just get in final thoughts from you post-market open. Just need to talk about some of those names. But 10 seconds left to market open. We'll start off on a slightly weaker footing. The question mark is whether we'll sustain at those levels or whether the expiry week volatility would come into play. But the start, actually not as bad as the SGX was indicating. The Sensex in particular, not moving at all, just about 45 odd points, about 0.25% for the Nifty. I think these rates will start weakening because the Bank Nifty is already showing signs of weakening. Started off flattish, now down about 0.33%. So do watch out for the Bank Nifty. This could well have a bearing on what the index does today. Though the calls on the Bank Nifty have been bullish the last couple of days. The mid caps and the small caps starting off on a flattish note as well. So not too much really to talk about here. Bring up the heat map. Wow, it's an envelope with a sea of red, hardly any green in today's session, despite the fact that the Nifty's just down about 0.33%, which points towards not too many big movers, but a clutch of names moving down in the session today. Look at this space of stocks which are flat, 0.1%, 0.11%. It's a large tick of stocks which haven't moved at all. Sun Pharma is down though, about a couple of percentage points. Infosys, a big mover of last week, is looking a bit weak in today's session as well, the bottom end of the screen. And Vedanta, Bajaj Finance are amongst the other stocks which are looking slightly wobbly. And not too many winners. I think ONGC and to an extent L&T are the top winners in state today. Just a quick check on specific stocks and things which are moving around. On news, so Friday's top gainers were Aurobindo Pharma and Infosys, and both of these are starting off on a weak note, as I said. Infosys in particular, down about 1.5% in trade today. The newsmakers then, and
a deal with Schneider in the offing may offer about $2 billion for the automation unit. This one is starting off or making L&T start off about 0.5% higher. Let's move on to some other stocks as well. The Adani Group and Adani Enterprises in particular taking a bit of a knock today post the Queensland poll. The exit polls suggest that the Labour Party might be coming back to power. That may not be viewed too positively for Adani. So this one is down. Big movers in Friday's session include Jacob, Praj and Future Retail. Future and Praj starting off slightly weak. Jacob doing rather okay, about 1.5% again in the session today. So a good start for this one. And last but not the least, a couple of newsmakers or the stocks which are in news. So GHCL, DSP BlackRock is bought about 1%. That stock is up 2.5%. And Vardhman Textiles, wherein Templeton is bought about 1%. The stock starting off about 1.5% higher. Pradeep?
So we talk about some more mid-caps, the ones which are down to begin with. HEG has opened weak, once again down 3.5%. PVR has lost around 3% in open. Praj Industries has come under some selling pressure now after stellar gains last week. You also have Lakshmi Vilas Bank opening lower. Edelweiss has opened lower. So these are some of the NBFC's banks that will also include Vijaya Bank in the list. Well, I think Bajaj Electricals was another key gainer last week, and that stock has also seen some profit booking in today's trade so far. On the positive side, we have Bharat Bijli on the back of strong numbers that the company reported, up 6.5%. We also have Kingfa Science up 4%, Excel Industries up 3.5%. These are some of the numbers that we discussed in pre-open session, and all these stocks have performed as per expectation. In gems and jewellery, you have a smaller stock, Tangamayal Jewellery, also opening up at 5%. Upper circuit. So this is another interesting play in this sector. Zuari Global continues to move up around 5% in today's trade. Saregama is doing well. And Saturn Credit, the company that is going to raise funds, is up 3% in today's trade as well. So there is a lot of activity in small cap side, actually.
Yeah, and certainly that seems to be the case. By the way, none of the indices are making a move which is over 0.5% either direction. Just keep that at the back of your mind. Final thoughts from our experts before we let them go. And Rahul, we've discussed NBFCs by and large and jewelry, gems and jewelry. I think you gave your thoughts there. If I just look at what's moving around in the banking space and not really NBFCs, there is a tick of green for certain private banks. Is there a private bank that you guys are telling your clients to invest into currently?
I think post results, we've upgraded Axis and ICICI. That's to in our favorite list now. I think that, you know, if we believe that going forward, the economic revival will happen and the lending will be done. And secondly, most important thing is that we are at the peak of the NPA cycle. That's what we feel in this sector. So I think in that space, ICICI and Axis is the two banks which we've been recommending to our client for in a portfolio and for a long term.
Just a quick thought on either of these two stocks, if you cover them before we let you go. J-Corp or FirstSource Solutions?
J-Corp, if we see the recent past trend during the last week, already the stock has shown a significant up move. So if I recommend to go a fresh entry in this, then the risk ratio won't be that favorable at current levels. So I won't recommend J-Corp at current levels, but FSL, if we see, then the stock has been in a consolidation phase. 45 would be the crucial level. Once 45 is broken, then you can expect levels around 50-51 kind of range. So we can keep a conditional trade to buy FirstSource Solutions once it gives a breakout above 45.
Okay. Well, with that, Sumit and Rahul, thanks a lot for taking time out for us this morning and joining in to this discussion. Well, if you look at Nifty Bank now, down 90 points. Nifty is down 33 points. And joining us now in the discussion is a very special guest, Harsha Upadhyaya, Chief Investment Officer for Equity at Kotak Mutual Fund. Harsha, good morning. Was it a disappointment for you as well when S&P didn't even raise the outlook for India as it was widely anticipated in equity markets on Friday?
See, most of the international rating agencies have been behind the curve, not only with India ratings, but many of the other ratings in the past. So to that extent, we believe that it's just a matter of time before they also start recognizing strengths of India and start looking at a better rating for our country. Nevertheless, I do not think that from an equity market perspective, the rating upgrade is so important at this point of time for immediate flows. I think the immediate flows from foreigners have been more or less stable and will likely remain that way even going forward. And on the other hand, we have a very strong domestic liquidity where domestic retail investors have been investing quite a bit of money into equity mutual funds and directly into equities. So that's helping the markets in any ways. So to an extent, while it's a disappointment, it's unlikely to alter the flow scenario for markets immediately.
Okay. So you mean to say that rating agency outlook doesn't really, affect the equity market outlook for a player like yourself. But what's your view? How comfortable are you in deploying the additional liquidity which is coming in at this level?
See, as far as markets are concerned, we all know that they are slightly higher than long-term averages in terms of valuations. So to that extent, when larger amounts of money come into the market at higher levels of valuation, it's always that much more challenging, which is the case even today. But as far as we are concerned, we are looking at it from perspective that maybe the worst is behind us, because September quarter results were pretty clean, in the sense that more or less in line or better than expectations. For the first time in last seven quarters, we have seen a double-digit earnings growth for Nifty, and that too without the support of oil marketing companies, without public sector banks or corporate-facing retail banks producing great numbers. Even pharma and telecom were a drag. So there were pockets which can actually start looking a little bit better going forward, and hence overall earnings can also move up quite nicely going forward. And anyways, we have the benefit of lower base because of demonetization that happened sometime last year around the same time. So December quarter and March quarter anyway have a lower base. And also there is some amount of sequential improvement that we have seen from March, June and September quarters. So that should continue giving us hope that while the valuations are high, there is no immediate negative that we are seeing on the earnings front which can derail this momentum.
That's interesting. Also, earnings probably in the next four quarters, Harsha, you'll probably have three, or next five quarters, you'll have three, which will have a benefit of a low base as well. My question, though, is if that is indeed the premise on which you were working your thoughts, with the money that is coming in to all you guys, where are you parking in this fresh money? I mean, you look at the large cap space, and there are hardly pockets which are offering growth available at par valuations. Almost all of them are probably priced beyond perfection. And please correct me if I'm wrong here. So if you're getting money, fresh money, are you necessarily moving and investing in the non-index large cap to the mid cap space?
It's a strategy which is a mix of both. There are some index constituents where we are investing today, and also looking at some non-index place at this point of time. But nevertheless, the focus remains domestic businesses as against export businesses, because domestic businesses we are seeing reasonable degree of strength in demand scenario, and also the pricing power seems to be more or less stable for most of the players on the domestic side. And more importantly, there is a lot of leverage that's there on the operating side, because most of the domestic companies on the manufacturing side have been working with capacity utilization ranging between 70% to 75%. As and when you see further demand improvement, these capacity utilizations will move up, and that's what we are betting on. And that will be significantly adding to their profitability as we move forward. And also, most of these companies have had the benefit of lower interest rates in the current context. So there has been nearly 150 to 200 basis points of correction on the interest cost, and that should flow through their profit and loss statement in financial year 19. And that will be a positive as well. So overall, we believe that some of the domestic businesses such as auto, cement, oil and gas, selectively some of the capital goods companies should report very good numbers. And on the consumption side, again, both whether it is FMCG pocket or even your consumer durables, both of them are showing a decent volume growth and sustainability of that volume growth. So more or less both consumption side as well as a little bit on the infrastructure side have been doing reasonably okay. And then we have this entire pocket of financials on because of demonetization, GST, and more people coming into the formal economy. We have already seen a more formal way of banking in this country, and that should be good for the entire financials pack, especially those who are linked to the capital markets, because that's another space within the financials where there is a lot of activity, and we believe that we are in for a longer secular growth in this pocket as well. So these are some of the areas where we have been positive on and continue to look for opportunities within these sectors. I'm not saying that these are the sectors where there is a large amount of valuation cushion, but this is the pocket where there is a certain degree of steadiness in terms of earnings. And in this market, that's more important than just going for pure valuations, because on the other side, you have some of the sectors which have been completely beaten down, but not showing any fundamental improvement on their businesses.
Harsha, just one quick thought on insurance as well. And one, have you invested any money? Two, if you have fresh flow of money, would you invest in what is turning out arguably to be a very large sector, but probably has this overhang of this change of tax rates? I don't know really how credible that is, because that's from a really old report. So I don't know if you can extend that to the current scenario, but the market seems to have extended it a bit. What are you doing here?
We have been positive on the insurance sector as a whole, both general as well as life insurance part of the businesses. We continue to hold some of the stocks in our portfolio, we continue to remain positive. Yes, I agree that any adverse change in tax rates for life insurance companies will be a negative, but it's very difficult to time some of these events, whether they will happen or not, that itself is unknown at this point of time. What we do is we take them into account in our valuations and start building in what will be the worst case scenario for some of these in case the tax changes do happen in an adverse way. But we are pretty much sure that this is an underpenetrated sector where the growth rates can be really, really strong for a considerably long period of time. And we have invested in some of the franchises which are really very, very strong in terms of both brand as well as the way they do their businesses. And we believe some of these will be very, very successful insurance ventures 5-10 years down the line. We are not really looking at what's going to happen in the next budget session in terms of likely tax change, etc.
One last question from my side, Harsha. We have been listening to some of these sell side strategists, and they believe that going forward, a focus is going to be on employment generating sectors, which means housing and related companies, textiles, leather, gems and jewelry, and sectors like that. Have you been increasing focus on these sectors?
See, as I said, since we are looking at more of the domestic businesses, many of these have already been covered in our portfolios. But just employment generation may not be the key criteria for us to really start go and build our positions. For us, what is more important is whether there is relatively higher growth in those pockets where we are investing, and whether those set of companies are available at reasonably better valuations compared to the overall market. That's what we continuously look for. And if we find those opportunities, whether it's in housing or in any other pockets of the economy, definitely we'll look at those opportunities.
Okay. Harsha, we'll leave it at that. Thanks so much for taking the time out and joining us and speaking with us at Bloomberg Quint.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a good day.
Thank you. You too. And that's Harsha Upadhyaya of Kotak KMC. By the way, ONGC remains the top draw on the index today, about 1.5% higher. On the losing side, HPCL, Infosys gives up some gains. It's had a very strong last week, down about 1.25%. Bharti Airtel and Sun Pharma are amongst the couple of other names which are just coming off a bit. But the index is doing, well, a lot better than what the SGX was indicating, keep in mind. At the broader end of the spectrum, Adani Enterprises and Future Retail amongst the losers. But hey, look at Bombay Rayon. That one is up 9% in trade. So this one continues its merry ways, 182 now and counting. On that note, slip into a short break. On the other side of the break, we discuss, we have a chat with corporates.
Firstly, the drivers for Nesco with Executive Chairman Sumant Patel. And then we discuss the road ahead for Motherson Sumi with Vivek Chaand Sehgal, of the man who runs the company, and speak about his vision 2020.
Are we live? Welcome to programming that's insightful, authoritative, and at your fingertips.
Bringing news alive. So immersive, so new, and so addictive, you will want it no other way.
The Bloomberg Terminal, accessed only by over 325,000 marquee investors across the world, until now.
Business people. Watching Indian Open. Welcome back. It's a big thing to own land in Mumbai, and when it's 70 acres bang on the Western Express Highway, it only adds to your value. The Bombay Exhibition Centre sits on Nesco's plot, and so do three IT parks and a fourth one that's coming up. Joining us now to talk about the future growth for the company and what its plans are with its remaining land bank is Executive Chairman Sumant Patel. Good morning, Mr. Patel. Thank you very much for joining us. We are familiar with what you've been able to do with the Bombay Exhibition Centre and your three IT parks at the Goregaon complex. What we'd like to know a little bit more about are your expansion plans or your expansion projects. So you are doubling your leasable space by setting up one more IT park. And I also believe that you're looking very intently at the entire food court business. Talk to us about how these plans will fructify, what the timeline will be, and what the impact on financials will be.
Well, as far as the Nesco IT park is concerned, we have three IT buildings, and the fourth one is under construction. IT building 4, the built-up area is around 1.7 million square feet, and the licensable area will be about 1.2 million square feet. So the building is making good progress. I think we have finished 7 floors. We should be able to complete the building, I think, mid-2018. So that will give us another 1.2 million square feet of leasable space, besides the about 900,000 space we already have in the three IT buildings. So this is as far as our IT park is concerned. We'll complete soon the fourth building. As far as the
before you get on to the food court business, could you explain to us whether you have any anchor tenants or already lined up for the IT park, whether you already have a fairly good idea of who's going to occupy it? And that certainty will help give you a clearer idea of what kind of revenue slash profit you will make from this fourth IT park.
You know, in our IT building 3, we have some of the leading corporates in the world, KPMG, Pricewaterhouse, Morgan Stanley Capital Index, HSBC Bank, and several other leading corporates, well-known world corporates. Some of them have shown interest, and we have had some preliminary discussions. So I think when the building is nearer finishing, maybe early next year, we should be able to finalize some license arrangements with the existing tenants. Quite a few of them have shown interest to expand their operations in our Nesco complex.
But do you have any fixed clients already for that space, for the fourth one? And B, what's your outlook on, you know, where rates are headed in terms of rental rates? Are you going to be able to expect higher rental yields on this fourth park versus the first three?
I think it's a little too early to finalize the final agreements at this stage, but we have had some initial talks and we are positive that once building is nearer completion, we should be able to finalize arrangement with some of our existing tenants. As far as the license fees are concerned, I think this will be a platinum certified building. It is the highest quality of building. Tremendous location. So I think we should be able to get reasonably good rates, slightly better than what we have in our IT building 3.
Okay, sir, you were also talking about the other businesses, one, the exhibition business, two, the food court business. Can you give us some details there?
Well, our Bombay Exhibition Center now has 6 halls. We added a hall recently, a few months ago. The area is about 700,000 square feet, largest exhibition center in India in the private sector, and also a leading exhibition center in the sense that there are more exhibitions held in Bombay Exhibition Center than in any other exhibition center in India. So now we have decided to build a new exhibition center, for which purpose we have appointed a very well-known architecture firm in Australia who have designed exhibition centers in other parts of the world. The designs are completed and we are shortly approaching the authorities for clearance to start construction. I think in the total, new Bombay Exhibition Center will be a little over 3 million square feet. In the first phase, we decided to build about 800,000 square feet, and we expect to start construction of the new halls, I think, mid-2018. This is Bombay Exhibition Center. Yeah. As far as the hospitality is concerned, we have recently built a kitchen. It's a world-class kitchen. Hygienic.
Okay.
And one of the largest in Bombay.
Sure. Sir, if I can come in, sir. The whole idea of my wanting to know about these,
yes,
is what's the kind of revenue uptick that comes in for you as a result of these businesses? Because we all know that your IT park business has been that principal driver of revenue. Now, with this expansion that you're doing in the food courts business as well, what's the kind of numbers that we're talking about? Not just necessarily in FY18, FY19, but let's say by FY20.
I would say that our two largest revenue earners would be the Nesco IT Park and the Bombay Exhibition Center. The hospitality group will pick up, I think, in about 2 years' time. So that will also add some revenue. And our capital goods division will have a smaller contribution to make. So looking forward, I would say that the Nesco IT Park and Bombay Exhibition Center between the two of them will contribute about 70 to 80% of the revenues. Then the balance will come from our hospitality group and the capital goods division.
Sure.
And our investments.
Okay.
I think this is the overall profile.
Okay. So let me ask you two questions, roll into one, Mr. Patel. One is, if I look at the last 4 years, you've doubled your revenues. Can that happen over the next 4 years from the current base? And if so, from a 308 crore top line, if I'm not wrong, and about 170 odd crore bottom line, what could these numbers go up to in the next 4 years?
No, I think we will definitely double our turnover in the next 4 years. Very little doubt, because once the last year our revenue was 350 crores. Once the IT building 4 is fully occupied, it will add about 200 crores as revenue. And once the new halls are built, that will also add significant revenue. So I think we will definitely double our turnover in 4 years. Perhaps we will do even better than that.
Wow. And what about bottom line, sir? 170 odd crores bottom line, if I'm not wrong, in FY17. What can it grow up to if your turnover will more than double in 4 years?
Our PBT, our profit before tax, in 2016-17 was 243 crores. And we expect in the current year to increase by about 15 to 20%. And we expect a significant rise once the IT building 4 is completed and fully occupied. So I think we are very careful to see that while we have revenue growth, our profit growth also keeps in line with the revenue growth. We would not like to compromise on the profit growth.
Okay. I have one small question as well. The whole expansion plan that you're talking about, this 1500 crores into various businesses, is there a need for Nesco to raise any kind of money for the same, or you will complete it via internal accruals and maybe some bit of debt, if at all?
The way we see the next 4 or 5 years, we should be able to complete the expansion of both the IT building 4 and the new exhibition center from our own funds. And we are not looking forward to going for any debt. I think with our cash flow, we should be able to finance the expansion in the next 3-4 years from our own funds.
Can you explain to me, sir, on how your hospitality business and the venture into food courts, etc., are, you know, margin different from how your other businesses are? And I suppose you, one thing is to be able to make these facilities available to in your existing properties. But do you intend to, over time, maybe only, you know, do independent food courts anywhere else? Is that part of the plan at all?
You know, when there are large exhibitions, about 15, 20,000 people come every day. So we wanted to provide them hygienic, world-class food, which is why we set up this new kitchen. So we expect to provide food first to the visitors to the exhibitions. But since we have built a very large kitchen, we are also now proposing to supply food to outside for outside requirements. So we are working on that also. I think in the year 2018-19, we should be able to increase our capacity use. And
so when you say, but when you say outside, are you looking at being able to be just a catering contractor For other facilities, or are you looking at maybe setting up independent food courts in other people's facilities, or what is the plan, if you could describe that to us? And does that, are the financials attached to that plan included in your comment regarding doubling of revenue in the next next year or two?
In the first phase, the hospitality will supply, manufacture, produce the food in our central kitchen here and supply the food outside. We have at present, we have no plans to set up new facilities, kitchen facilities outside our complex. I think we would first like to see that the new kitchen we have set up, very large kitchen, about 25,000-30,000 square feet area, over 15 crores. So we would like to first see that the existing kitchen supplies good food to the visitors to the exhibitions and to some of the customers outside.
All right, Mr. Patel, we appreciate you speaking with us this morning. Thank you so much for the insight you provided into your business plans. That's Sumant Patel of Nesco, detailing the company's future expansion plans and the ability to double revenue and substantially grow profit in the years to come thanks to those new projects. All right, we've got a couple of comments coming in that we wanted to play to you before we went to our next management conversation. Here's Timothy Moore, Chief Asia Pacific Strategist at Goldman Sachs. He's talking about interest rates globally. He expects them to remain where they are. And he also sees four Fed rate hikes in the year 2018 as U.S. growth gains. Let's listen in to what Tim has to say.
Interest rates next year globally are likely to start to rise because we're pretty much at full capacity in many economies, notably the United States, where the unemployment rate is all the way down at the low 4% level. And we, and certainly the market, expect the Fed to raise in December. The market's pricing one Fed hike next year. We think there's going to be four. So we're a little bit more hawkish there. And the metaphor we're using, which I think is a really useful one, is what we call the growth and rates jaws. So the idea is that the upper jaw is that growth has been rising this year, but the lower jaw, which is interest rates or more broadly financial conditions, has been falling, i.e. widening. So the jaws are kind of wide open, and that's been a very fertile environment for equity markets globally and also very much including Asia. Next year, we think the upper jaw, the growth, is going to stay stable, but the lower one is going to start closing somewhat.
Well, but the interesting bit of this chat that he had with Bloomberg as well was their reiteration about how they believe global growth is likely to pick up. Remember, it's a discussion that we had last week as well, Goldman Sachs' opinion on what global growth could look like. They're probably not in the majority, but they have their own view. Chetan and I also spoke, of course, about the global growth in calendar year 18 at 3.8% versus what's happened in 2017. So that's the other interesting bit of conversation that we've had on Bloomberg Worldwide, and we'll bring in some snippets of that conversation during the course of the day as well. But just a quick check, really, on what's happening within the equity markets before we move on to our next discussion, because we have maybe just snipped a little bit from where we were, about a third of a percent in the red. And led down predominantly by what's happening to OMCs and heavyweights in the IT space. So HP, BP, both of them are down. GAIL is down in the session today. So that one is down about 1%. Remember, GAIL was a big mover in trade last week, amongst the biggest gainers last week. Infosys, in terms of heavyweights, is down about a percent, percent and a half. Again, a stock that gained big time last week. It was amongst the principal contributors to the Nifty gain last week. And that one, too, is down in the session today. And banks are not picking up. Remember, SBI is trading about a third of a percent in the red. And Bank Nifty is just not moving along in this expiry week. So that's something you have to keep in mind. And amongst high flyers, which are down, future retail, after a fabulous move last week, and more so in Friday's session when we had a 9% up move, future retail is giving up some of these gains. So 620, down about 3.5%. And Adani Group, and Adani Enterprises in particular, is down. But hey, GHCL, guys. We spoke about this fundamental news as well, caustic soda prices and what it does to the margins and the business of companies like GHCL. That stock is up 6.5%. DSP BlackRock bought about 1% or 1.2% of the company at about 262. The stock is up at about 291. So that's a big move that's happening in GHCL in the session today as well. So some newsmakers certainly doing the rounds. The big surprise, though, is Jay Corp, which is up about 3% yet again. I don't know what's happening. The stock is up whopping 50-60% in the last 7 days.
All right, we have our next management with us.
Yes, Motherson Sumi as well. The management joins us. They recently highlighted in their investor meet in the moving towards the Vision 2020, reiterating the growth targets that they had. But I think they also gave a sneak peek into what the company could do beyond 2020. And I think those plans entailed moving beyond the automotive business as well, if I'm not wrong. But let's get in Mr. Vivek Chaand Sehgal to talk about all of this, about what this whole electric vehicle buzz is about and whether companies will get impacted ever so immediately or will it happen over a period of time. Mr. Sehgal, good having you. Thanks so much for joining in. You know, before we talk about Motherson, just where, I request you to wear the industry hat and tell us, a lot of investors are worried, and worried may be a strong term, but are a bit unsure about the impact that this whole electric vehicle influx will have on the auto component industry, not necessarily for you, but for the industry at large. Do you think it will be fall off a cliff, or will it be a lot more gradual in nature?
I think what's important is to understand whether it is possible for you to actually compress time and then do it. At this particular moment, the electric vehicles in the world are not even, in our estimate, it's around 770,000 cars a year, while the total sale of cars is approximately 92 million cars. So I really don't understand why everybody is so fearsome of this particular change. It's not a disruption, it's just another option to drive the car. I mean, there is no, whatever the hype that people are creating, we are okay with that. As Motherson, we are agnostic to it. But I feel that it is a bit overdone. There's a lot of possibilities. It's a very exciting thing. But the first Porsche made in the world was an electric engine. So people have already been there and come back. There are certain challenges. Those particular challenges have to be overcome. And depends upon how fast the world will react to these requirements. And if they react very far, all the governments react very well, well, it's going to happen maybe in 10, 15, 20 years. So we're okay with that. And it also opens up tremendous amount of opportunities for existing technologies to also disrupt this electric vehicle. So, you know, we can go on.
Let's talk about the company, Mr. Sehgal. I think this investor meet that you had fairly recently, if I'm not wrong, spoke about you reiterating your Vision 2020, which is revenues at about $18 odd billion and the return on capital at about 40 odd percent. What's the ask rate, Mr. Sehgal, from where we are right now to that point of time on an annual basis for Motherson Sumi? Because the notes say that their estimates were slightly lower. They were happily and positively surprised, or happy and positive with the reiteration that you've done. I just wanted to know what's the ask rate.
So, you know, ask rate and all these particular things are something, if you have a strategy for this particular, you know, that I have to hit $18 billion or something like that. Motherson never has such kind of philosophy. We are a globally preferred solution provider. At this particular moment, we are inundated by requests from a lot of the car makers and vehicle manufacturers, which are asking us to look at companies which are in trouble and things like that. So for us, our job is to ensure that our stakeholders are people who have confidence that Motherson will not grow only for top line. In fact, we follow our guru's principle, which is top line is vanity, bottom line sanity, and cash in bank reality. So I personally believe that Motherson has a clear commitment to its target. We feel that if things are as they are coming, we should be in a position to achieve our 2020 target with 40% growth, and maybe even a year earlier if two or three things happen very quickly. So we believe that the whole management has its head on its shoulders, and we will not get carried away only by top line. Because if the news was in the papers which has been printed for the last 2.5 years is to be believed, then we would have already crossed our 18 billion. So it's not such a impossible task or something for us.
Mr. Sehgal, good morning. This is Menaka here at Bloomberg Queen. Just curious, I understand that over the last 2 years, both your geography and client mix have seen big changes. Can you talk us through what you expect the trend will be in the next couple of years?
There is not much left, really, to whom we are not supplying. What we do is we have a clear strategy that we have a 3CX15, which means no customer, no country, no component, more than 15% of our turnover. And in this age where all the models are getting squeezed up and the model life is getting shorter and shorter, this augurs actually very well. Because what we are doing is we're not committing to one customer, one model, and one component. We're into multiplicity of components, and we will keep on increasing our content per car. So when we increase that, we can easily increase our targets to what we are talking about. So it's not about, it's not related to the car production as such. It's more towards what we call the content per car. So if I'm supplying $100 to a car, can I supply 150? That's already 50%, 30% up. So in that sense, Motherson is moving. And that's how in 1993, we were only $2.2 million. Today, we are $9.2 billion the last year. So that's the growth of 4,500% is because of increasing content per car.
No, I get that. I just wanted to try and understand if we are going to see, for instance, I'm looking at a Deutsche Bank report on your company that suggests that customer concentration is decreasing in line with what you've just explained to us. The revenue share of Volkswagen and Audi has come down from 34% to 24%. Daimler share has doubled from 5% to 10%. I just wanted to know if what we can expect in the next 2 years, not just in terms of client mix, but also in geography mix. And whether that has any substantive, especially the geography mix changing, has any substantive impact on your financials?
So, great question. The point is, you know, it could depend a lot upon our acquisitions and what components we are going to acquire, what companies in which geographies. So one doesn't plan on something which we really can't control. Because if we are to follow our customers' dictate, then we are always open to ideas, open to new geographies, open to whatever they want us to do, as long as we are solving their problem. So really, we don't spend too much time thinking on these particular things.
Okay. You made a comment in an earlier answer where you said that your clients have been reaching out to you regarding companies that are not doing very well. I imagine you were referring to, and correct me if I'm wrong, your acquisition strategy from here on. Can you talk us through what that's going to be? I'm sure it, is all in best principles that all companies follow. You will look for value, you will look for quality. But any geographical specifics that you can give us in terms of your acquisition strategy, or even what kind of money you're looking to put behind inorganic expansion?
So let me just correct you a little bit here. Motherson has never grown because of our own strategy. In fact, we have 19 acquisitions to date. We have 39 joint ventures. And every one of them except one, which was the original one of wiring harness, which Motherson did of its own accord, all others are having some way or the other trying to solve a customer's problem. So we've never woken up in the morning and said, okay, I want to acquire this guy or I want to acquire this guy. So we believe that our niche area is to help the customer solve his problems globally. And that's why we can give you umpteen examples, like, for example, an American company asking an Indian company to go down to, say, South Africa to solve their problem. So we are agnostic to just the thought that, you know, we're going to conquer the world tomorrow or something. We don't like that idea at all. We just follow. And in fact, this particular strategy was visioned in our annual report of 1997. So it's already 20 years of great success in following this particular strategy.
Sehgal, just curious to know what's left to buy, where you're looking next.
Oh, we still don't do more than 2% of any particular car, 2.5% at the max, I think. So there is a lot. And believe me, we have a huge pipeline of requests from the customers, what they want us to buy. And we believe that that is enough for us to cross our 2020 target.
And they are still looking at other areas too, beyond automation or automotive rather. I think the latest analyst meet threw some light to that as well. But would have loved to chat about that to Mr. Sehgal, but I'm sure there are other opportunities to do that. We are out of time on this show. Thank you so much for taking the time out though and speaking with us today.
Thank you for having me.
That's Vivek Chaand Sehgal, the chairman of Motherson Sumi Systems. Fairly bullish and fairly optimistic, or confident rather, of them meeting that 2020 target of $80 billion in revenue. But with that, it's a wrap on this leg of Indian Open for sure. We'll leave the markets the way they started off, about a third of a percent lower. The mid caps and the small caps too, not too troubled, just about the same vein as the large caps are. But I'm sure a lot of trading ideas on the FNO show. So that's coming up on the other side. Stay tuned to Bloomberg Quick.